Right. Well, welcome back from break, and thank you all who have made it through the whole 2 days. You get a special round of applause, and then for everyone, we're really glad that you're with us for what is going to be a really eye-opening panel. Very pleased to present a group of not just donors, but we know them all to be real advocates for everything we've been talking about today: gender equality, inclusion of all people of different gender identities and sexual orientations, and definitely of adolescent youth. Wanted to first introduce our moderator, Don Steinberg. Many of you know him from his previous role as deputy administrator at USAID, and a big advocate for the gender equality policy that is there now. Now he's serving as president at World Learning. Aldijana Sisic, who is the chief of the United Nations Trust Fund and Violence Against Women at UN Women. Musimbi Kanyaro, who is the president and CEO of the Global Fund for Women. Bill Costello, who is the Minister Counselor for International Development Branch at the Embassy of Australia here in Washington, D.C. Rebecca Terzeon, who is the Coordinator for Gender and Women at the UK Department for International Development. And Susan Markham, the Senior Coordinator for Gender Equality and Female Empowerment at USAID. Please help me welcome them all. John, take it away.
Thank you. Well, thank you to our panelists, and thank you to all of you who have lasted the whole day. We have saved the best for last. So I am delighted to be able to moderate this panel, which means I'm going to stay out of it as much as possible. I am not a donor right now. I left USAID 3 years ago. I like to consider myself a recovering donor. And so I'm going to ask some of the questions here that I've always wanted to ask myself when I was at USAID. And I wanted to start off with Adolescent in terms of the work that you're doing, maybe just a very quick explanation of what indeed the UN Trust Fund to End Violence Against Women is. I know you've got priorities of preventing violence, expanding access of women and other survivors to services, and strengthening laws. But how would you describe your work?
Well, that's a very big question for a short time. But first, can I just say one thing that I have to acknowledge, and that is so many young people here in the room. I love it. So fantastic. I usually sit in those meetings, and there's a lot of my generation, I would say, not so young, not so old. But to see the our young leaders in this room, that is very encouraging and very inspiring. And this is what one thing that Trust Fund does as well. We put the focus a lot on funding, for example, youth-led organizations that are dealing with the issue of violence against women and girls, violence against adolescent girls, et cetera, as one of our priority teams. But just quickly, we are a 20-year-old fund. This year, we are celebrating our 20th birthday. We focus on those three specific areas which you just spoke about. We have funded over 400 organizations in over 120 countries. Currently, we are funding about 111 organizations in 76 countries, which with a portfolio of almost $60 million. Our focus is small women's organizations with funds between $50,000 and $120,000, as well as larger and medium organizations with funds that we provide from $100,000 to $1 million. And some of the key areas we focus on are conflict and post-conflict, HIV and AIDS, as I said, youth organizations, small organizations, adolescent girls. Just briefly, sort of, and shortly, trying to be very short.
Thank you. Musimbi, you run the Global Fund for Women, and you have committed yourself to address challenges related to sexual and reproductive health and rights, creating strong women, freedom from violence, creating safe women, and economic and political equality, creating powerful and heard women. You're celebrating just about your 30th anniversary. Yes. Tell us a little bit about the fund.
Yes. Thank you very much. The Global Fund for Women exists to ensure that we get resources, which is money, to where it's most needed, and that we actually make sure that women and girls are heard. Agency is very important. So those two are what helps us to do grant making. We focus on those groups that would otherwise not get funded. Some of them are small, with a budget of between $50,000 and $200,000. So far, for the last 30 years, we have funded over 5,000 groups, and we've spent nearly $150 million. We were founded in the Silicon Valley. We have offices in New York as well. And we fund globally. We've been able to reach women and girls in 175 countries. We were one of the first funds to have an established fund for the girls' education that was an endowed fund that we have leveraged over the years before this became a popular subject. So we know how to reach girls and how to reach women, and I'll be telling you about it later.
No, I'm really excited about the fact that people are jumping on the girls' education bandwagon. We had a great event over at the State Department the other night where Michelle Obama announced a whole series of partnerships, and it seems that we're having the private sector, the international institutions, and certainly donors and civil society joining that process. Bill, representing Australia here, you're the Minister Counselor for Development, and I assume that means you're the representative of the Australian Aid Agency in the United States. And Australia has really provided leadership in the area of addressing disability rights, in particular for adolescent boys and girls. And I wanted to ask you to sort of elaborate on why that area is so important to Australia and what are the implications of that?
Thanks, Don. Yeah, that's correct. We were driven about 8 years ago by an inspired political leader. His name was Bob McMullen. He was our minister, and he challenged us to take the lead in the donor community on disability inclusive development. And we haven't mastered the subject yet, and there are not enough donors with us on the journey, I have to say. But we've got some significant achievements, and we've learned a lot in that time. I think some of the key learnings are that disabled people are the most disadvantaged and marginalised people in developing countries. If you're a disabled girl in a poor community in the developing world, you face a triple whammy. You face poverty, you face gender discrimination, and you face the discrimination on the basis of your disability. You may be shunned by your own community, you might even be shunned by your own family. You're less likely than your girl peers to complete education, to be literate, to have the opportunity to access a job or have an independent income. You'll find it harder to access the services that others can access. And unfortunately, you're statistically more likely to face sexual or other forms of violence. So what can be done about that? I think there are so many options, but three things stand out in particular. One is we have to work towards providing equality of opportunity for disabled people. Disabled boys and girls particularly need to get equal access to education as just the first step in their journey towards on the path of equality of opportunity. And this can be done by donors and NGOs and others either working at the school level or working at the national level with countries on the policies and strategies that enable the disabled to get access to schooling. The second thing we've found is really important is to give disabled people a voice. And one of our key strategies is that we've been active in supporting national disabled people's organisations so that those organisations can speak for the disabled in their countries and in their language. And then the third thing, it's quite practical but important, is we have to count disabled people. Mm. They're often hidden within communities. Data on disability is extremely scarce in developing countries. So when we as donors or development practitioners are supporting censuses or household surveys or even local project-based surveys, we need to remember to pursue disability aggregated data in the same way that we continue to struggle to make gender disaggregated data the norm. And finally, if I can just mention one other thing,
please.
Don. Recently at the World Humanitarian Summit in Istanbul in May, the first ever charter on inclusion for persons with disability in humanitarian action was adopted.
Absolutely.
And over 100 agencies and donors signed the charter. We're really pleased with that as a first step, and now we all need to focus on implementation, ensuring that the charter is integrated into our and other humanitarian organisations' guidelines, and most importantly that we put it into practice on the ground in crisis situations.
Great, thank you. And I'm going to give you a preview of the question I'm going to ask you in the second round, which is there tends to be, when we have mainstreaming and integration of these exercises, a failure to provide resources actually for incorporating disabilities or incorporating LGBT rights or even on occasion incorporating gender rights. If it's a health project, if it's an agriculture project, an energy project, it is frequently the implementer that has to come back and say, we want to create universal design in this space. And are we getting beyond that? Are we focusing finally the resources that we need in this exercise? So a nice easy question for the second round, which is why I give you a heads up. Rebecca, at USAID, I think we always had DFID envy because we always saw DFID as having an agenda, a clear focus, a long history, and it is true that in the area of adolescent girls, you've taken the lead in the past, and now that we have adolescent girls at the heart of Agenda 2030, what are the particular aspects that we're focused on in terms of tackling harmful practices or economic empowerment and participation?
Okay, thank you for the question. So the first thing I'd say, I think, is that DFID has been prioritising women and girls at the heart of its work for a number of years now. At the end of last year, we made a commitment to put young people at the heart of our development work. And I think we've developed a youth framework, and I think those two things overlaid on top of each other create a very powerful commitment for adolescent girls. I won't rehearse all of the arguments that have been discussed in the last couple of days about the importance of the adolescence period. Suffice to say that we really subscribe to the fact that the adolescent years are critical years where pivotal decisions are taken, where social norms are hardwired, and where the cycle of poverty is reinforced. So we have a big focus on adolescent girls. When it comes to tackling harmful practices, so we recognise that practices like GBV, like FGM, like child marriage, are all rooted in those social norms which perpetuate gender equality. And we recognise that adolescents are particularly vulnerable to those harmful practices, and that we need to work with young people, girls and boys, in the early adolescent years in order to tackle the harmful practices and to tackle the social norms that perpetuate them. So what DFID's done in this space? Well, one of the things we've done is we've tried to show leadership in bringing some of these really quite sensitive subjects into the mainstream. So having the conversation and encouraging others to have the conversation. And an example of the work that we've done in that area is the Girls Summit, which our Prime Minister hosted with UNICEF in 2014. And that secured commitments to end FGM and child marriage within a generation. And there have been a number of Girls Summits nationally since then. And then on the programmatic side, we have a large program, global program that we fund, which is active in 12 different countries to accelerate the pace towards ending child marriage. We have a large FGM program, which is active in 17 countries and aiming to reduce the incidence of FGM by 10%. By 30% in at least 10 countries over the next 5 years. So there's lots of programmatic work as well as the leadership and advocacy work. And then you asked about women's economic empowerment. I think, of course, girls' education that we've already touched on and women's economic empowerment go hand in hand. And those two areas of work are priorities for us in our gender work. When it comes to the leadership and advocacy role, we too are holding a girls' education forum in early July. And that will look at what works when it comes to improving education, particularly looking at the barriers in adolescence, and what are the actions that need to be taken in the hope that we can secure commitments to deliver those actions. And then, of course, there's the programmatic side as well. We've talked already in the last couple of days about the Girls Education Challenge program, so I won't talk more about that. But there are lots of programs that we have at the country level as well, supporting girls' education. And then I think really the SDGs have pushed us into thinking more about the secondary education and how we support women into active participation in society and in the economy. And we're very excited in DFID at the moment about the high-level panel on women's economic empowerment, which people might have heard about, which the UN Secretary General has convened. Our Secretary of State, Justine Greening, is a founder member of that panel. And really, our ambition for it is that it will come up with groundbreaking recommendations for what needs to happen to accelerate the pace on women's economic empowerment. And on the programmatic side as well, we're starting to think a lot more about these programs that help adolescents move into productive employment. So just to give a couple of examples, in fact, yesterday I think there was a panel that looked at a program in DRC called La Pépinière, which is on women's empowerment. Engine, which is educating Nigerian girls in new enterprises, is another example of a program that helps girls to develop the skills and move on from education into employment. So I could talk a lot more about any of that. I've probably talked enough. But just to say, I guess, that I think the role of the donor is very much more than about funding and programs. You know, there's a leadership and advocacy role. There's an innovation role and a challenge to keep pushing, you know, all of us to design policies and programs that are really going to make a difference.
So I'll give you a heads up on your question as well. I'm always intrigued when we talk about girls' summits, because clearly there is the notion that we need to involve the people who are affected by our programs in the planning, the implementation, not just as beneficiaries. But how do you deal with a 13, 14, 15-year-old adolescent girl who doesn't truly know what the policy options are? What kinds of training do you have to do? And how do you do the training without stifling the excitement that they bring to this exercise? It's a challenge we all have when we bring talented young people into our organizations and then we say we're going to teach you the ropes. Well, they know how to tie those ropes in ways that we've never even considered. So how do we handle that? Susan, if I have diffid envy, I have Susan envy as well. You have been such a remarkable advocate for women's rights, for gender equality and women's empowerment, both on the Hill and now within USAID. And one of the things that you've always been known for is partnerships, bringing others into the process, recognizing that government or in the previous case, Congress couldn't do it on their own. AID is a leader in that space with thousands of partnerships at play. How do you balance the need for aggressive action with a single entity forcing it with the need to get ground truth and resources and technology and the convening authority that you do?
Well, thank you so much. I have to say, Don, I did feel a little bit as a disadvantage on this panel since you used to work for USAID. I thought the questions might be more probing for me than the others, so I'm ready for some deep...
That's the second round.
Okay, great. That's a, but I do, I mean, coming from an advocacy background, I think for me, reaching partnerships was a natural place for me to go, and trying to make the tent as broad as possible, besides probably speaking more frankly than I probably should as a government official. But I think that the way I'm at a great point at USAID because the whole organization is really thinking about partnerships very broadly. We're thinking about not only what USAID can do with partners like here on the stage, but also with the private sector, as has been referenced before. You know, companies who are looking to both do corporate social responsibility, but also doing the right thing in their business model. And so partners like Coca-Cola and Intel and Microsoft thinking strategically about how to accomplish their goals while helping development issues. But then we also have great partners in our donor governments. And more we're reaching out to the governments where we're working. We've always partnered with them as ministries of education or energy, but really helping them think about what they need to do to make these programs sustainable over the long run. So on a USG panel yesterday, you know, Kathy Russell was talking about the importance of the policy and the kind of the diplomacy side. But on the development side, we're working with these governments with their tax systems, kind of outside the gender and adolescent girl realm. But really, how do they you know, do away with fees for secondary education, or how can they invest their citizens in some of the gender role change that we're trying to do? So really partnering with governments. In Bangladesh, we had a program. We were doing a lot of awareness raising and education about changing social norms around girls' education, and we started a best school for girls contest, and the schools themselves really took it on, and they thought, what can we do to encourage girls to stay in school here? But I have to tell you, when the government comes on board, and they have a full press release and a press conference, and then they play one of the videos that we've made on national TV, right? That's just beyond anything that I think we had thought of maybe 5 or 10 years ago. But if you can do that, it really becomes transformational.
Absolutely.
And then within there, we're trying to think more creatively, creatively, oh my gosh, I'm losing my words at the end of the week, creatively, about what we do with those partnerships. So it's not always exchanging money, but it's thinking about resources that they have that the US government doesn't have access to, whether it's people or
right.
technologies. And as referenced previously, we try to push each other. You know, we might be the slow, lumbering kind of bureaucracy. They want to move more quickly. So how can we take advantage
right.
of that, where they can take advantage of some of the relationships we have with governments and individuals around the world? So really thinking outside the box on partnerships.
So I want to right now ask you, when you're bringing so many diverse groups together, they have different goals.
Yeah.
A soft drink company may be interested in creating clean water, but that clean water is for their bottling plant and has to be a such higher level of purity that it is not appropriate for the basic water system that you're trying to address. How do you balance that?
There are a lot of conversations, and I think we've become better at having those conversations earlier.
Exactly.
So we're not so far down the road and they're like, oh, what are we doing here? Because, for instance, some of the business groups that we had talked to years ago, they really wanted to help women entrepreneurs, which we love women entrepreneurs, but not every woman is going to be an entrepreneur.
Mm.
How do they get into the formal labor sector, right? We don't want them just selling goods, but how do they get into the jobs with benefits? You know, sort of thinking broadly about economic empowerment. So I think having those conversations earlier about really how we are not sacrificing the development goals that we have, but that they can also see a little bit broader about how it impacts them, because it's not just selling more goods for them or getting clean water, right? They're helping these communities who are then consumers, who make decisions about how money is spent in their country. And so maybe taking a step back about how they think about what they want out of it helps them think a little bit more broadly about their goals as well.
Excellent. Adolescent, I want to follow up on the partnership question with you, because you, with the fund that you're operating, and UN Women in particular, have to deal with so many different UN agencies in the UNITE process, as well as host countries, as well as civil society groups. And increasingly, you too are looking at business as a partner in this space. How do you reconcile all of this?
Well, I just want to pick on, I think Susan has really laid out great ground for explaining what partnership actually is. You know, we, for example, in Trust Fund, we don't call it donors anymore. We call it partners, because it's not a bank. We are not a bank that you just, we take money from somebody and then we just want to circulate money to somebody else. There's a much bigger process in building the relationship in which we all understand what our common ground is and our goal. So I take a stand from the point of advocacy. We are all advocates. I think that's how we were introduced as well. Because look, if you take umbrella of SDGs, yeah, we were talking about economic empowerment, and then we have this each goal that has a target, an indicator, and it's sort of separate in its own universe. But to achieve all SDGs, mm-hmm. you cannot look at the issue of violence against women just as a goal five and as a one target. You have to look at it through all of the goals. You know, you can put as many girls as you want in a school, but if they're being sexually violated by their teachers, school administrators, or their peer group, they're going to leave the school. They're not going to get education. You can create the stalls at markets to give women jobs, but if there's no safe space for them, if they're being raped at the markets, they're not going to come to markets. So this is where the partnerships come into it. To achieve the goal 5, 3, 7, 8, 9, 12, whatever we have, I don't even know how many we have, but we need a civil society, yeah? We need the people who actually know what's happening on that ground, and who know what the solution is, what the, you know, what that activity, output, outcome, whatever we want to call it in our monitoring and evaluation systems, is the most appropriate for that culture, for that community, is it local, national level, etc. And then you need, if we talk from the UN perspective, you need the UN agencies who then have a different mandate. They will look at the issue from a different lens. So UNICEF will look from the lens of girls. We will then say, okay, where is the gender component? UNFPA will look at it from the point of family. And we also can play that bridge, for example, between civil society and the government. So we can bring everybody around the table. So you need somebody to do that as well. And we can bring the money as well. And then you have a government. Nothing happens without government, of course. So in the end, everything, for example, from the trust fund point of view, when we are raised as a donor, we are investing in projects that we want to see being institutionalized into the overall national response and budgeting. We want to move away from the donor model into institutionalized response. So yes, we, you know, innovative projects, we identify them, we find the best practices, we invest the money into those. But after 3 years or five, when we withdraw the money, when we say, okay, now the project is finished, we want to see the projects that are replicated into the national response so that the government takes the funding, or that they're sustainable in another way, or that they're funded by national budgets. So for all of this, in every of these areas, you have a different agency, you have a different stakeholder, and we have to talk together. Because, you know, I have two stakeholders at this panel, DFID and Australia. They're our donors, as they know that. I'll talk to you later. And for example, our strategy for 5 years, 2015-2020, was developed with our donors. We sat down, not just with our donors, but with the USA, with Norway, with Sweden, with civil society, and said, okay, we want to work on issue violence, this one, we want to make a difference. What do you think? How do we do it? We can't exist just with a single-minded agendas, because at least I can speak from issue violence, this woman, we will never make a difference that way, unless we come together. And occasionally we will have a different directions, but the goal will be same.
I think that's fascinating, because if you think about the amount of resources available to donors, and then you start comparing it to domestic resource mobilization, you know, in the case of USAID, for example, we used to be very proud that we were giving $30 to $35 billion as a country. And then you think to yourself, private American citizens give about $40 billion, remittances are $200 billion, private sector investment is $1 trillion, and domestic resource mobilization in those countries themselves is $8 trillion. And so it is really about using those funds in order to be a catalyst, to bring new ideas to the table, to use the convening authority. So it's a great point. Musimbi, your organization really does focus on grassroots institutions to a great extent. And one of the keys in that area is to have this basic notion, as you say, that communities, countries, and economies are transformed when women have basic rights, are involved with their own economies, etc. Has that case been made to the countries that you operate in? Are men convinced that that's true? I noticed that we have 80% of this panel are women. That tends to be the case in many of these discussions. How do you interject this into the power structures?
Okay, Don, I'm going to take some time to explain, because I think it's a privilege for me to speak here as a donor, but also as a grantee. Because when we come to the table as the Global Fund for Women, we're coming as a fund that was established by women, because they saw certain barriers that were there in front of civil society to get money from donors and to get money from multilateral donors as well as from bilateral donors, their own governments, our own governments. So I want to answer your question by bringing out some of these things that are important, which we have learned over the time. One is resources are important, money, education, skills, collecting data are very important, but they become better when the people that are so-called beneficiaries are completely in the center of influencing how they are done. That sometimes is not the case. And we see it clearly, and the way that we get informed, which I think helps me to answer your question, is that because we are part of the activist movement, we're part of the activist movement, and we fund from underneath. We fund from those women that are the ones that are, they could be handicapped, we fund disabilities, we fund LGBTQI, we fund poor women, we fund women that have domestic violence, who are living with HIV and AIDS, etc. So, and they are part of the board, they are part of the decision makers. Things that are important for donors, we asked to talk about how donors can play in support of gender equality. Make it easy, we have to make it easy for people to get the money. You can't make so many rules that the people who are on the grassroots can't apply for that funding. There are many government funds that are inaccessible because they are just too difficult to access. Secondly, languages. Lack of access has many aspects of it. In our case for the fund, it's an international fund. We fund internationally. But we accept grants in many languages. We accept it in Arabic, in English, in Spanish, in French, even though we are a smaller fund. But in that way, we have had for 30 years participation of grassroots women. Make it easy. Take the burden on yourself if you're the donor. Don't put the burden on the grantee. The third thing that has been very important is to actually ensure that when we do data collection, we don't use our grantees as just data collecting centers, and they don't know how that data is used. They need to be able to go back with the learning, which we try to do, that we have learned, and say, this is what we learned after we saw 100 of you, 300 of you, 3,000 of you. We get 3,000 applications. Because when you don't do that, that data is used at a very high level, and it doesn't impact the lives of those people by them owning that data. So return the data to the people who you collected the data from. And if you use the people to do the data, like what we do a lot of times right now, whether it is by mobile phones or by people keeping records, over records in microfinance, etc., they need to know what you have done when you aggregate. Because the role of the donors, these convenings, these other things that we do, it gives us a bigger picture than any individual has. So the responsibility really is larger. If you have got more money, more power, more authority, you have to bear more responsibility. And we've learned that by being a grant. Then regards to convincing people to accept, we believe in the Global Fund that the best way to make something become convincible is to support people to become movements. Because movements outlast people, individuals. Movements have the power of taking on not just what they deal with, but anything that they can see is either disruptive in a good way or disruptive in a wrong way. So if we're funding FGM, disability, or whatever it is, they will know, or sexual reproductive health, they will know when there's injustice in another area that is not their area, and they will jump right in and become activists for that area. Civil society healthy in every country you fund. If the civil society is healthy, the services will get to the people. If the civil society is healthy, there will be less corruption. There will be more inclusion. So our grant making really is supposed to keep civil society healthy so that governments can be healthy and multilateral organizations can be healthy. This is really important, and we found the experience of 30 years is that civil society often is under attack, and the space is not given to them. And the women's human rights advocates are often, when they take up issues, especially of sexuality, of violence, of rape, of lack of technologies that are appropriate for themselves, they are not always safe. And I think donors, both in government and multilateral areas, should really know that when civil society is safe, then they will change their attitudes. Men are becoming more aware of these things. So I should say, when you say, do you convince men? Men are part of the societies, and I personally, at this time in the history of our world, I am extremely pleased that there are more people, men and women, who are hearing this and articulating it different. Whether it's the McKinsey study about parity at work, or the SDGs that say you have 17 SDGs and every one of these has a gender aspect of it, and you have a specific gender SDG simply to be able to check on the others, I'm very pleased. And now what I want to see is more resources invested in making sure that the gender equality really becomes a reality. Now, for Global Fund, we can be a really good manager for funds from governments and from multilateral sections. Because, as they say in Asia, if you cook rice, you cook it from up and from down. And if we really are about leaving no child, no adolescent, no woman behind, leaving no one behind, we cannot only afford to fund large international organizations. We have to fund little women's groups, individual girls that are going into the STEM action and doing something. So we are there as the Global Fund and our systems of funds to really look out for you as governments and for you as multilateral organizations that no one is left behind. That's what we do best in our grant making.
Just a couple of responses to that. At USAID and now at World Learning, we have a catchphrase that we use, which is nothing about them without them. And I think that is, it comes from the disability rights community, but I think it really exemplifies the need to go in with humility and to listen to the ground truth. Secondly, I love the fact that you've identified that funding institutions to do things is one way of building them as institutions. And we tend to forget that. But when you go to an institution and you say, you do the survey, or you distribute the humanitarian relief, or you train the teachers, it creates that strength there. And I love your comment about civil society, because I've been in this area for 40 years. I have never seen civil society under attack in country after country as it is right now. And I'm delighted that people are stepping up to address that concern, but it is not just in the traditional countries that we think about, but it's really spreading, including in many cases, developed countries, including our own. So it's a deep concern. So I asked, how do you make sure that the priorities for disability rights or LGBT or any of these provisions are in mainstreamed into the health programs, the education programs? How do you make sure that the finance minister is as much an advocate for disability rights and as the disabilities ministers is?
Yes, it's a good question, Don, and I think it's a challenge that we face with the sort of the mainstreaming question across a whole range of issues, as you've identified. I think the first thing is you have to win the argument. You have to win the argument that this is not only about allowing people to realise their potential, but in so doing, it's about contributing to the human and the economic capital of the country. And so there's an economic return on this, as well as a human dividend, if you like. And I think that's really important to do. And I think once you've made that argument, you have to then move on to make mainstreaming or make attention for particular groups the norm. Make it part of the rules of play. I know there's always a strong call for a rights-based approach, but I think there's a huge amount to be said for a rules-based approach, which is it's part of your procedures, it's part of your rules, you have to do it this way, so that it's the norm rather than the exception to include people. So you don't have to go out of your way to make an effort, it's expected of you that you do that, or the law requires it, or your procurement guidelines require it, or your project rules say that this is how you should operate. And then I think the third thing that's really important is to show people how to make it work. Many times people will say, yes, but that's expensive, or yes, but I'm really focused on my main goal here. I haven't got time to add another thing. But if you can provide some expertise or give some case studies or show people, here's a really smart, easy way to achieve a goal that's complementary to what you're trying to do in health or education, then you can nullify a lot of those objections as well. And just coming back to disability, where I spoke earlier, our disability team within the Australian Aid Program has a panel of experts that are ready on tap, so that if somebody says, okay, I'm interested but I don't know what to do, they say, okay, we'll provide you with some support from people who've done this before.
I'm speaking with Charlotte McLean and Clapo the other day, who's the World Bank Coordinator for Disabilities, and she said that if you get it in the original design, it basically costs you 2 to 3%. If you have to retrofit, it's 30%. And so there's a real purpose in doing it right the first time. So, Rebecca, how do you listen to young people and respect their views, but yet incorporate their vision into, you know, the tough challenges we're facing?
Yeah, it's a good question. Thank you. And I think the answer is mainly about making sure, so our recent experience of working increasingly with young people is that we have to ask young people to tell us how to engage them. So it's not a case of us, you know, as DFID, although we do have schemes which do this, but kind of employing more young people and kind of, you know, turning them into DFID and development clones, as it were, and kind of beating the youth out of them. But
it's a human rights concern. But
it's about, to give you an example, we hosted a youth summit when we became increasingly interested in working with young people. And it was young people who designed that summit. And there were 300 delegates, and they came to tell us what are the opportunities and the challenges that they face as young people, and how can we help them. But they designed that summit. And I mean, in a similar way, actually, I mentioned that we're hosting a girls' education forum in a few weeks' time. And we've consulted with young people on how we involve them and engage them. And there's going to be a big concert on the evening of that event, which I'm sure wouldn't have happened otherwise. But that was what young people wanted. So I think it's very much about kind of engaging people on their terms and not on our terms. It's about language. It's about talking a language, not saying you have to talk the language we speak, but at the end of the day, we're all human beings and we were all young once. And the language might be a little bit different nowadays, but it's, you know, it's not assuming that everybody, that there's a, we have a terrible tendency in development to use acronyms and to talk a kind of language that nobody else understands. So it's using a language that we all understand. I think that's the main thing. It's talking each other's language. It's letting young people tell us how to engage them on their terms.
On that language question, I remember being in South Sudan talking with a 12-year-old, and I really wanted to know what grade he was in, so I was asking him, "Who are you?" And he said, "Oh, I'm not a student. I'm a stakeholder." And I said, okay, this has gotten entirely too far now at this point. So
I think the other thing I would add, sorry if I may, is that, because I think in your question you asked something about how do young people know about the policy frameworks and what difference we can make. I would almost say kind of leave the policy to the boring civil servants, if you like, but it's our job to listen and to understand what young people want and to turn that into the policy framework that makes sense in our world.
Excellent.
But I don't think we expect young people necessarily to kind of understand and to to articulate what they want in those terms. That's what we need to do.
Please, absolutely, Adolescent.
I just wanted to say that it's also starting from the point, we often hear people say, oh, these are the young people, they're our future, they're leaders of the future. We have to scrap that. That's not true. They're already leading from their own levels of engagement, from their own understanding, from their own life experience. You know, talk about a boy or girl who is living in a poverty. They have experience that poverty, and they're speaking from their own perspective. Or a young 13-year-old who cannot come out as a gay person or lesbian because of their community. They have experience, so that they can tell us, actually, how can we work in their community, because they can't come out. So recognizing that they are already leaders, they are not future, they are now.
But it's also important that they be able to communicate with those who have the power. And I think about this a lot because, for example, women in northern Uganda are leaders in their societies. And yet when a peace negotiation occurs, it's the men who are there, because we haven't articulated what the language is that you need to adopt in a peace process, and therefore they are excluded in that process. I've talked with Betty Bagambi a lot about that, and it's very concerning. Yes, Susan.
Across a lot of the work that we do, the time that, you know, I'm asked to tell stories from my travel, and I'm like, why don't we have more actual voices from those countries at the places? And so the balance between where I might be able to go up to the Hill and talk to U.S. Congress people, and we don't always have folks from the beneficiary countries where we are, so I can do that when appropriate, but then more importantly, having young people, having women from these countries tell their own stories and be able to firsthand. I mean, you were alluding to that, but I think we have that balance all the time in programs like this in northern/western countries. I mean, I think that was great about the Girl Summit. Went after London, then it went to Africa. Yeah. So it wasn't that we were just talking to ourselves, but we were really moving it around. You guys really did a great job of that.
So Susan, I had the hardest, toughest question you can imagine, but I think you influenced our organizers, because they've asked me to go directly to the audience at this point for some Q&A. But did you want to make a point, Musimbi?
I think I wanted to make a point in regards to understanding or not understanding a policy, or speaking about the issue, somebody else speaking for you. You see, I believe in age-appropriate information. And age-appropriate information, what it does is it takes something like a policy, and if you're going to deal with the 8-year-old, and there's a policy about 8-year-old, there must have been a reason that made the people think there should be a policy about 8-year-old. And if you cannot be able at that particular time to find a way in which they understand what it is and speak about it, then something is wrong with those who make the policy, not those for whom it is supposed to protect. I have found throughout my whole life, I have worked with the young people. And that's actually my vision, my dream is that as we get older, we move off and they take over. And I try to practice that in many places. And what happens with the young people, they understand quite a lot, but they tell it in their own language. And it is us who are older that haven't learned their own language. And so we exclude them, and they don't have the power to actually say they know what is important for them. And this goes whether you're talking about disadvantaged people, women, or whatever it is. People always know what's important for them. But you've got to be able to give them the space to say it in their own language and take the word language in a big frame. And I think that I have seen, whether it was the young woman who was introducing the president yesterday, she did it in an articulate way. I don't think she was any different from an adult, and maybe she was better than an adult could have done it.
Absolutely. Thank you. So we've got about 20 minutes for questions, and I'm going to call on people as I see them. So the blonde woman in the back. I don't know, that's probably not the right thing to have said, but you're standing up, so it probably worked.
You didn't call me a broad or anything, so no. That's all right. Okay. For a third time, I'm Noelle, Women Thrive Alliance. My question is for Rebecca, and I'll preface it by saying, Aldijana, Emery, I love what you said. So I don't entirely agree that the policymaking framework should be separate from youth's participation, that we should be taking their voices and funneling them into the work that we're doing in policymaking. Our role should be making that policymaking framework and process accessible, as we've said, so that young people are able to participate in it in their own language. And what we really need to be doing, right, is provide them with the resources, the tools, the knowledge, the funding that they need to be able to participate in that. And we've seen young people here already who have been participating in policymaking. We saw Chair Nerbaugh yesterday, former chair of the Youth Advocacy Group from the UN's Global Education First Initiative, who had a huge influence in SDG 4. That's policymaking that youth could participate in. And so I would love to hear from the panel, how do we go forward and make these frameworks, these policymaking processes, more accessible to young people and bring them into the decision making instead of just listening, but letting them speak on their own and participate on their own?
Who would like to take that? I think she was,
I think it was aimed
it
at me.
You, Rebecca.
Yes. No, thank you for the challenge. It's a very fair challenge. And I think that's exactly where we want to head for. What I meant was that I wouldn't want the fact that, you know, there is a current language that we speak in the developing world, in the development world, to act as a barrier to young people from having their voices heard. So I guess it's a process. And what I'm saying is, essentially, we've woken up, finally, and pushed in part by all of the dialogue around the development of the global goals, to the fact that we need to be, you know, speaking on an equal footing with younger people, and we need to have a policy framework, lexicon, that makes absolute sense to younger people. So I think it's a process, but I certainly wouldn't want the language that we use today to act as a barrier from young people's voices being heard. I mean, we, you know, do take a look at the youth framework that DFID has now published. It is all about young people not being recipients of aid, but being agents and being advocates. And it's all about how we want to support young people to have that voice and to have that agency. And there are all sorts of activities happening across DFID, you know, for example, focus groups, which, you know, have happened for a long time, and I absolutely take the point about not just listening, but going a lot further than that. But there really is a very genuine intention to try to bridge that gap, and I hope we get there.
And I think we should magnify those places where it's happening. Malawi, a couple of years ago, raised the age of marriage, and in order for that to happen, a lot of young Malawians took part, and specifically the girls. I think we should, when we hear the success, we should magnify it. We should really put a light to it. And there are so many of these little successes that are already happening that need to be heard by everyone. And I think that will help to put into place the fact that young people are already active for themselves wherever they are in other places.
It's also important. It's also important from the standpoint of saying this is not a Western agenda that we're trying to impose on countries around the world if it is homegrown.
There are some agendas that are actually Western agendas or put in a Western role. And when that happens and we find ourselves doing it, we should be able to ask, did we listen well? Or there are sometimes, most agendas are universal agendas. I believe that. Mm-hmm. But sometimes it's the way that they are carried out that can either have a complete African agenda or Western agenda or something about it. But I think most issues that I feel are important are universal issues.
Absolutely.
Yes. If I can Please. Say from a donor perspective as well, I think there is a responsibility of a donor in this very much so. And we need to be sensitive to, for example, when allocating the grants, are we funding organizations that work for youth
work with youth or are actually youth-led organizations. And I think that's where we are have to make the difference, huge difference, and that's how we open opportunities then for youth to identify their own agenda and draft their own way of doing it. And of course, they still have to follow results-based management.
Please. Right there. Because I'm not allowed to refer to hair color anymore.
You have one on your right.
Hi, I'm Catella Gator. I'm a feminist. I have sensed over the last 10 years ago, there's been a huge opening in the gender environment. And I'm just wondering from the perspective, from the donor perspective, what you attribute that to, what has been working, and how can we accelerate that even further?
Susan, can I ask you to take that one on?
Sure. So that's a great question. I mean, it's so many little things that come together to create the wave that I hate to pinpoint any specific point, but I do have to say that I think Beijing 20 years ago captured a lot of movement that had been going on in lots of places around the world and really brought it together, and with some of the high level proclamations and speeches really laid down a groundwork for things that have happened over the past 20 years. I think that also as we've increased measurement, that has helped us with sex disaggregated data, but also just starting to measure these things, we could really see that things that we thought were true about resources going places or rights that people had or didn't have, we could really mark it. I mean, one story that I've heard that the reason that primary education has really all the gaps or a lot of the gaps have closed around access to primary education was because it was one of the few things out of the millennial development goals that we could actually measure on a wide scale. And so we really could catch it up. And so I think around gender issues, and looking at not just gender issues, but across many sectors where there were gaps between men and women and boys and girls, we can see that now. And it's just become a lot easier to tell the story. And then finally, I think that we more and more can tell the story, many stories, around when you do take gender into consideration, it makes a huge difference. And we could, some of these, the president had a great quote on Tuesday. He said, you know, I deal with a lot of tough issues. This one, like, we know what the solutions are. Why don't we just do them? He said a lot more eloquently, of course. But, you know, and that's the thing. I think we have the stories. People are like, oh, of course we have to deal with women. But when we've actually shown those stories, I mean, places like in Pakistan, in USAID's work, we were doing energy programs, and we were trying to measure the efficiency and how much electricity use. And, you know, we're really working with those extension workers where we now employ women as the extension workers because they can get the electricity readings in these homes during the day because only women are at home and the men weren't able to collect any of that data. So just doing little things like that that aren't specifically gender, but when we talk about them and take into account the different roles that men and women play, it can really make a difference. So I think it's kind of a combination of factors that have really added up. I always feel like we're on the tipping point because I'm an optimist, but I really do feel that this is, although there's many kind of challenges to the work that we're doing, that it would be very hard for us to backslide now. The networks around the world, the knowledge that we've gained, the movements that have been created, I think we're on a great path, and so many things have added up over the past two decades and more.
Susan, one thing you didn't mention was individual leadership. And I really do believe, and I'm not going to get political here, but I really do believe that Hillary Clinton and Milan Vivier and Cheryl Mills and Susan Rice and a whole variety of individuals put this agenda front and center and said, we wake up in the morning thinking, what can we do for gender? And I think that did change things pretty dramatically.
I do think when people who don't have gender in their title talk about it, it is a huge impact. Not just male champs, but like you said, Susan Rice and, you know, people in the defense industry and other parts of government. I mean, the work that Karen Grohn and others are doing at the World Bank to bring finance ministers together to talk about gender issues. It really does become real integration and really mainstreamed instead of just something that people are checking
absolutely.
The box.
Absolutely, and so we'll add Michelle Flournoy to that list as well. So,
but also people owning their own power. One of the things that has really happened where the greatest change is on the question of violence. The reason that we hear a lot more is because women and girls and others have owned their own power to, and they want to say no to violence. So they can speak out more. And when people own their own power, a lot of things come onto the ground. So I think that's another place where we've seen it work. And how do people own their own power? When we work a lot on issues of agency. And women have been saying this for a long time, but now we have great reports like from the World Bank and elsewhere. When people are respected and they have their own agency, they are actually able to do more. And I think the other thing that I want to mention is that we now talk about these things or talk about women and girls or adolescents, not as problems, but as part of the solution we want for everything. So it's the cost of inaction is so expensive for all of us that we know that if we act, then it saves and brings a lot more in the area of development for all nations, for men and women, for countries, for the economy, for the place of work. And these things have been practiced whether from industry or from social, civil society, social change, etc. So we see quite a lot of things that work, more things than work that work than those which don't work. What is needed is the will to do what works.
Yeah, I love the fact that we are not, please. I love the fact that we don't talk as much about the youth bulge anymore. We talk about a demographic dividend. And I think that this, that language is important. Please. No, right here.
Yeah.
You'll get a mic.
Thank you. Hello. Yeah, thank you very much. I'm Santosh from India, and I'm a transgender representative. So my question to all of you here, that we are having a global fund from FTAM, GFTAM, which is finished now in India. The thing is that the community is in danger now, because the global fund mandatory on that time, they told us that they will empower making the capacity of the organization and hand over to the government. Now the government is not willing to take a single organization, and they at least created 250 or 30 organizations in all over the India for MSM transgender hijras. But now the condition is very much critical. The government did not want to take, the community is an outside, they are in the out phase, where they will go. So I request that when you are making the policies, can you please read down or revise the policies until and unless the government will not take up the funding should be continue for them, the organizations. Otherwise, the main in Bihar, two of our friends are suicide just because of them, they are coming out from the society, they identified themselves as a gay, and after all that the all facilities stopped, where they will go. The first. The second is that I don't know, is it any specific program in India is running for LGBT people or not? So if anybody can be, respond, that will be great. For me,
great.
I'll get the information. Thank you.
Anybody want to take that on?
I can talk to you off camera, but we do fund LGBTQI groups in India and in other places that are very difficult. So they exist. And then talking of Bihar, which is also one of the places that I've worked really extensively, there's a lot that is going there by various donors, private foundations specifically. The foundations, the foundation that I worked for before going to the Global Fund, the Packard Foundation, it invests quite a lot of money in Bihar and Jharkhand. And also I know that the Gates Foundation invests a lot of money in family planning in that area as well. So I have some knowledge from a donor's perspective for both Jharkhand and Bihar, and can talk off camera.
That's great.
I can make a general comment on the subject of the other global fund, the Global Fund Against AIDS, TB and Malaria. The problem you raise is real in a number of countries, so it's not unique to India. We've created support mechanisms for community groups and so forth that as countries graduate because their economic indicators go above a threshold, there's not been enough time to prepare for sustainability. And as you say, a lot of governments are hesitant to support these civil society groups. So it's not a unique problem to India. It's a problem that donors have been discussing with the Global Fund. I think one of the solutions is to perhaps come up with some regional approaches which get beyond just the question of the sovereign decision of the government. But I can say that as donors, we're aware of the problem that you're talking about.
I think this is an extremely important issue on many levels, and that is about our own funding modalities and the length of the funds provided. Yeah. So, for example, on funding issues of Alan's Guest Women, currently we are providing funds for 2 to 3 years. There's a clear that the projects don't achieve anything in 2 to 3 years. So there's a need for 4 to 5 years funding in order to make them more sustainable, in order to make them or bring their capacity to the level where they can continue to fund themselves or raise the fund from another donor. And this is particularly important when it comes to funding the projects that actually do address the broader spectrum of the human rights violations. Yeah? So when we go beyond just domestic violence, so I mean, without undermining the issue of domestic violence, but when we go into areas of culture or the laws and et cetera, et cetera. And I think Bill is right that this is something that donors are very much discussing. I know in a fund we are thinking a lot about this extended periods of funding. How do we ensure that the project can continue where it's needed for various reasons?
So we have time for one question, and who's going to go home tonight and say, damn it, I didn't get to ask? Okay, that right there, please.
Hi, my name is Caitlin Figueredo from Australia, so I'm actually really glad to see Mr. Costello here. I am creating a gender equality program right now for the UN, but my question is, we've been talking a lot about using youth to design policies from the ground up and working with different agencies and governments, but a couple of years ago, the Australian government created a board of youth from around Australia to design and recommend policies for the government. So they worked for an entire year and they created a lot of amazing policy recommendations. However, once the year was up, because of funding cuts and because the Minister of Youth was stepping down, nothing happened. And my question is, as youth, we really want to help you. We have a lot of resources, we've talked about it, but how can we make sure that if we work with you, how can we ensure that what we recommend actually happens and actually takes place and with implementation? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And anybody want to take that on? Mr. Australia.
All of my policy recommendations get implemented either, I can assure you. So, I mean, what can I say? There's an art and a craft, and maybe people who've worked on the Hill in DC should be answering this question, but there's an art and a craft to getting your recommendations agreed, and I think it involves dealing with officialdom at different levels. It involves dealing with civil society organisations who are advocates, as we've all heard about, and it involves dealing with the political level, and sometimes you have to play a long game and talk to a wide range of people who may in future be in a position to remember that idea and take it forward. So, but we've all been in the situations where we're on a committee who had great recommendations and then the moment passed and it didn't happen. So you're not unique in that experience, and I'm sure Australia is not unique in that experience either.
So I would add to that, no, I'm sorry. I would add to that simply that it isn't so much a question of playing our game, it's a question of defining your own game. And I really firmly believe that. I think that the old systems of, you know, how we do things are being changed so dramatically by technology, by youth empowerment, by the fact that 15-year-olds actually are coming up with solutions through science and technology and engineering and mathematics. that the world is changing, and it isn't so much about getting 63-year-olds like myself to accept your vision. It's establishing a new vision, and I'm the one who has to run and catch up with you in this area. So I'd like to give everyone one last moment to say a couple of sentences that you would like to share at the end of this remarkable two-day process. So we will start with Aldijana.
Me? Oh, okay. Well, I'm going to build right on your question. Don't give up. That's my message to you. Just keep asking, keep following up. What happened to our recommendations? Because I think that, and that I think we found that in all of our jobs, if you give up on asking or if you give up on trying to get your agenda forward, we wouldn't have SDGs today. We would just agree all that MDGs failed and that was good, but we said that wasn't good enough. I think that's the, it's a kind of the life lesson as well. You just have to keep going. You have the skills, you're all good leaders, there's agenda we all need to deliver, so just keep going.
Two things are important for me. Investments in young people and adolescents is the way of looking into a better future for the world. And we should actually make sure that there are enough resources. But what's important for me is that these resources actually go directly to them and they don't get cut in between to side things. Then the second important thing is that young people are part of communities. And I'm telling you, when you deal with young people and their children, their mothers are important. So we need to make sure that women have resources directly so that they can invest in their communities more, and that women who are doing this from a human rights perspective, who are keeping the environment safe, who are making sure that there are good laws, good regulations, for helping to change cultures that are not good for the next generation are well funded. And I can tell you today, with the information that we know, the worst funded groups in the world are women who are organizing to bring change in their communities, and young people, girls who are organizing to bring change in their community. And we as donors here should really try to wear these lenses and say, what does it mean if you could give money directly to the women, especially in grassroots areas? And if you don't have a proper answer of the process or how to measure the impact, ask us at the Global Fund for Women, because we have developed tools for measuring the impact, for collecting data, and we can share with you, because those tools have come from grassroots women and girls. That's what I wanted to say.
Well, Don, you said earlier that the way policy is made is changing rapidly, and perhaps what we haven't explained sufficiently on this donor panel is that the donor world is changing very rapidly. Well, there are all sorts of new actors. Some are private sector, some are non-profit, some are philanthropies, and so it's a very diverse landscape. So When Susan talked earlier about the importance of partnerships, couldn't agree more, but I think the very practical point about that is you just have to talk to a lot of people, but when talking to them, you have to understand the constraints and opportunities from their point of view. Whenever you want to achieve a partnership, you have to understand the other partner and what they can and can't do with you.
I think I would build on that to say that, I mean, I agree with you that the world is a very complex place, increasingly so, and I think there's been a real realization recently. I agree with the lady who said that, you know, there has been fantastic progress in this area, or a kind of realization that we must focus on gender equality over recent years. And I think with that realization has come that everybody has a role to play, everybody has a responsibility, everybody has a lot to contribute, and everybody can benefit. So if there are, from individuals to kind of sectors of society who aren't with the program yet, then we have to take the argument to them. And if there are individuals or sectors of society who believe that they don't have a role to play, then we have to convince them how they have a role to play. And I think the global goals really are a once-in-a-generation opportunity. I know we heard earlier today that somebody was saying, but do they go far enough? And, you know, that's a fair question. But I think they are about as ambitious as we could have hoped for on the gender equality program, and we need to take that opportunity.
Great. Well, I'm going to add on to what you have said before. Two summers ago, when we were in the middle of the Ebola crisis, my instinct was, well, I have to go there. I have to help. Like, what can I do? And we had two or three different emergencies going on at the time, and I was very frustrated sitting in an air-conditioned, windowless room in Washington, not really feeling like I was making any difference. And some smart person at USAID said, but what can you do from where you're sitting? You're not a doctor. God forbid, we're not letting you into Liberia. But what can you do from your seat? And that's, I think, the role. You know, all of us donors, we couldn't be all the same. We have different functions. We support donor. We support other organizations and individuals in different ways, but also all the individuals in this room. So as an adolescent, you have access to things that we don't, probably technology that I don't even know that exists. You have ways to communicate. You have things to add, your perspective, which is unique and as important. And so bringing those different perspectives together in a way and everyone understanding what they can do from where they currently sit is the way that we're going to get this done. I often think of the girl in 2030, and, you know, how old is she? Is she just being born this year? How is she going to, you know, change the, or help us achieve the 2030 goals? Everyone has that role to play, and I think it's important for us to remember that.
So just to conclude, just wanted to say one thing. 50 years ago to this day, Robert F. Kennedy was in South Africa trying to encourage people who were suffering under apartheid to keep the faith and to keep working for social justice. I was 13 years old at the time, and he gave a speech that I'm going to quote a part of here that has been in my wallet my entire life, and it inspired me at the age of 13. He said, and I quote, "It is from numberless diverse acts of courage and belief that human history is shaped. Each time a person stands up for an ideal, or acts to improve the lot of others, or strikes out against injustice, he or she sends forth a tiny ripple of hope. And crossing each other from a million different centers of energy and daring, those ripples build a current which can sweep down the mightiest walls of oppression and resistance." So we here today are the tsunami of 2016, and thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was amazingly inspiring, and I have to thank our donor panel for giving us some great ideas and allowing us to feel like we can engage these individuals and engage each other in this process of trying to identify the challenges, the solutions, and the way forward. I am so thrilled with the way that the last 2 days have evolved. Thank you so much for coming and joining us during the 2016 Gender 360 Summit. We've had amazing participation from such a diversity of voices. So many inspiring ideas have emerged about how we engage adolescent girls and boys in achieving gender equality and combating gender-based violence. And we want to particularly thank our youth advocates and youth participants who've done such a great job of keeping us old people on our toes. As the director of the gender department at FHI 360, I am thrilled to have such a phenomenal team who have all come together to make sure that this summit is organized really to the highest quality, they know I have very high standards about the way that this summit should be and should look like. So I'd like to thank a few key people who played a tremendously important role in helping organize this event. Really, for the last 3 to 4 months, we've been working on it. Starting with my team at FHI 360, Elise Young, who is the senior advisor for gender mainstreaming and thought leadership. She always has a tremendously high level of energy, great ideas, and great commitment to engaging young people. I thanked Emily Brown earlier, who had to leave to attend a wedding, who makes sure that we have a very expertly organized event. Eric Weber, who is our gender department intern, who managed the RSVP list and who gave me literally hourly updates on our numbers. Aham Kays, who took care of the travel and made sure many of our participants arrived safely and had a place to stay when they got here. Helen Albert, Jennifer Linkletter, Rebecca Sewell, who helped manage the various tasks running around with the microphones, and thank you very much for that. And Marcy Ramsey, who is a moderator for our GBV services panel. From the Plan USA team, Justin Fugel, Keshet Dovrat, Marsha Odell, Anne Hudak, and two interns who sat at our registration desk, thank you very much, Plan USA. From the MedEngage Alliance, Oswaldo Montoya and Lakshman Belbase. From Social Development Direct, Carla Hawk and Rachel McGrath, who came from London. And USAID, I want to particularly thank Deanna Prieto. Is she here still? Yay, Deanna. Deanna was absolutely fabulous and very, instrumental, the instrument that helped put the U.S. government panel together and made sure that all ran smoothly. Thank you very much, Deanna. Thank you to our speakers, moderators, table facilitators, and those of you who took time to travel here from long distances and short distances, spent the day with us asking questions. What should you expect next from us to come out of this summit? We're going to be creating a highlights video, so we will get that up probably in about a month or a month and a half. We'll have full video files, pictures of the whole summit on our gender360summit.org website, and you can visit that website now. You'll see all of our past summit information you can access there. We'll have a Storify, which basically gathers all of the social media that came out of this event. We'll put it all in one place, and you can see that also on FHI360.org as well as the Gender360Summit.org. And we will be putting together a short document that will highlight many of the challenges, solutions, and recommendations that came out of the summit. Finally, we would really love if you could do a very short evaluation for us. There's, I think, in all of your tables, you still have baskets with little pieces of paper. If you could write one thing that you really liked about the summit and one recommendation for what we can do better or differently next time, we appreciate your feedback. Finally, travel safely back home, and we look forward to continuing this conversation with many of you. Thank you again.
Sorry, I just wanted to say one last thing. She doesn't usually get a lot of recognition, but we wanted to take a moment to just lift up Andrea Bertone, who I must say, and I've worked with a lot of social justice folks over the years, she is one of the strongest fighters for gender equality, female empowerment, social inclusion, and social justice who I've known. Will you please give her a round of applause?
Thank you all so much.